Okay, before we start, I want to ask you, when I talk about Oprah, then what do you know about her?
Oh, sorry, I don't know.
Anything else?
I don't know.
Okay.
Oh, she's a girl. No. Yeah, female.
Okay. Okay, about Oprah, we will think about her for the famous four points. One is talk show. She has a talk show and she is a host. And she has a production company and name is Harpo Inc. And she is an actress. You can, if you want to see her drama, then you can see this drama, The Woman of Brewster Place. This is a mini drama, mini series. Then the last one is the Philanthropist. And she takes care about children a lot. So she founded the Family for Better Lives Foundation.
Okay, now we're going to talk about her in her life, and one part is from early life. So, on her first identification, her name is Oprah. It's not Oprah, it's Oprah. And history.
a woman that we all know. Last woman speaking is not powerful. That she is the one of woman. Her speaking is powerful. Then because she is talking.
She's a media producer, actress, talk show host, and philanthropist.
She's best known for her talk show.
She is worth $3 billion.
She's Oprah, and here are her top 10 rules for success.
The way through the challenge is to get still and ask yourself, what is the next right move? Not think about, oh, I got all of this. What is the next right move? And then from that space, make the next right move, and the next right move. And not to be overwhelmed by it because you know your life is bigger than that one moment. You know you're not defined by what somebody says is a failure for you, because failure is just there to point you in a different direction. Nothing about my life is lucky. Nothing. A lot of grace, a lot of blessings, a lot of divine order, but I don't believe in luck. For me, luck is preparation meeting the moment of opportunity. There is no luck without you being prepared to handle that moment of opportunity. And so what I would say for myself is that because of my hand in a hand and a force greater than my own, I have been prepared in ways that I didn't even know I was being prepared for. And the truth is, for me and for every person, every single thing that has ever happened in your life is preparing you for the moment that is to come. You don't have to hold yourself hostage to who you used to be or anything you ever used to do. Because who has lived and hasn't made mistakes? When I think about my 20s and what a foolish girl I was and how I would give over my power to men who really didn't mean me well, but now I hold no grudges against them either because I realize I'm the one who gave over the power because I didn't know any better. And now that I know better, I know I don't have to do that again. It's one of the most powerful lessons any of us can ever know. I say to my girls all of the time that your real work is to figure out where your power base is and to work on the alignment of your personality, your gifts that you have to give, with the real reason why you're here. That's the number one thing you have to do, is to work on yourself and to fill yourself up and keep your cup full. Keep yourself full. Now, I used to be afraid of that. I used to be afraid, particularly from people who say, oh, she's so full of herself. Oh, she's so full of herself. And now I embrace it. I consider it a compliment that I am full of myself. because you only when you're full, I'm full, I'm overflowing, my cup runneth over. I have so much to offer and so much to give. And I am not afraid of honoring myself, you know. It's miraculous when you think about it. And I would say to my team, well, doesn't matter, because every season somebody else was coming out. One talk show, two talk shows, three talk shows. There have been over 100 talk shows since we started. But every time, I would feel like, all right, gotta step up our game, gotta step up our game. The way you step up your game is not to worry about the other guy in any situation, because you can't control the other guy. You cannot control the other guy. You only have control over yourself. So it's like running a race. The energy that it takes to look back and see where the other guys are takes energy away from you. And if they're too close, it scares you. So that's what I would say to my team all the time. Don't waste your time in the race looking back to see where the other guy is or what the other guy is doing. It's not about the other guy. It's about what can you do. You just need to run that race as hard as you can. You need to give it everything you've got all the time for yourself. My grandmother was a maid. That's all she ever knew. The only real expectation she held for me was that I would one day become a maid and, in her words, have some good white folks, meaning people who would not speak negatively about me, who would allow me to take food home, who would be good to me, would treat me with some level of dignity and respect. That was my grandmother's dream for me. But I had another dream for myself, another more than a dream. I had a belief for myself. And I remember watching her hang out clothes on a line one day and say to me, you have to watch me, Oprah Gail, because one day you'll have to do this for yourself. And knowing inside myself that that was not going to be my life, don't know how I knew it, other than that thing that we all have, intuition or an instinct that said, no, this will not be my life. But because I sensed that, and was connected to that. And I remember it was a very still moment. It was quiet, and I was still, and I was watching her. I could see her right now with the clothespins in her mouth and putting them on the line and seeing the breath, because it was cold, the moisture coming from her lips. And I knew that that would not be my life. I knew that I will not be hanging clothes on a line in a backyard in Mississippi. So I was either 4 or 5 years old. And that belief that that would not be my life is what I held on to for the longest of times. I just, no matter what, believed that there was something bigger, greater, more for me. I always understood that there really was no difference between me and the audience. At times I might have had better shoes, but at the core of what really matters, that we are the same. And you know how I know that? Because all of us are seeking the same thing. You're here at this fabulous school, and we'll go out into the world and each pursue based upon what you believe your talents are, what your skills are, maybe your gifts are, but you're seeking the same thing. Everybody wants to fulfill the highest, truest expression of yourself as a human being. That's what you're looking for. The highest, truest expression of yourself as a human being. And because I understand that, I understand that if you're working in a bakery, and that's where you want to be, and that may be what you've always wanted to do, is to bake pies for people, or bake cakes for people, or to offer your gift, then that's for you. And there's no difference between you and me, except that's your platform, that's your show every day. So my understanding of that has allowed me to, you know, to reach everyone. And there's no way that you wouldn't, because that's what I truly feel. A lot of people don't know their purpose. And if you don't know your purpose.
you need to overcome the blocks, then you can know what you want to do, then what you want to be. Okay?
Why is Thomas Edison significant? Because a lot of people think he was the first guy who invented the light bulb. He spent two years to invent the light bulb. Let me show you a video.
Thomas Edison was born in Millen, Ohio on February 11, 1842. He didn't learn to talk until he was almost 4 years old. In school...
It's too fast.
Thomas Edison was born in Millen, Ohio on February 11, 1847. He didn't learn to talk until he was almost 4 years old. In school, he often daydreamed and was labeled as mentally slow by his teacher. Because of these comments, young Edison's mother took him out of school and homeschooled him. In 1854, his family moved to Port Huron, Michigan. Edison sold candy and newspapers on trains. He became a telegraph operator after saving the daughter of a station agent from an oncoming train. He moved to Louisville, Kentucky in 1866 and became an employee of Western Union. Starting in 1872, Edison worked on the quadruplex telegraph system. It allowed telegraphs to send and receive four signals at the same time on the same wire. Edison's system wasn't a new invention, but an improvement on the duplex system created by Moses G. Farmer and Joseph Stearns. Edison's first invention was a phonograph in 1877. Many people today incorrectly associate the phonograph with the record player. Edison's device recorded sound out of cylinders and was geared as a recorder for the voice, not for recording and playing back music. It was a gramophone that recorded to discs and became the record player that we know today. Edison did not invent the first electric light bulb. He invented the first commercially practical incandescent light. Edison bought the patent on what was probably the first invented light bulb. Later, he came across Joseph Wilson Swan, who had developed and patented a working light bulb. Edison made Swan a partner and eventually bought him and his patent out, giving him full ownership of the patent. Edison patented a system for electrical distribution in 1880 in order to capitalize on his electric lamps. Edison used direct current to power his system, which had its limitations. And when these limitations were made public, Edison launched a propaganda campaign to convince people of the superiority of direct current. This war of the currents, as it was called, brought in the involvement of Nikola Tesla, an inventor and rival of Edison, who would create the alternating current power generator. Alternating current eventually proved to be a better system of transmitting power. In 1888, Edison started working on inventing a motion picture camera. Edison passed on the work of creating the camera to one of his assistants. Edison himself had very little involvement in the invention. On May 20, 1891, the kinetoscope and the kinetograph were revealed. Moving images were taken with the kinetograph and shown through a peephole on the kinetoscope. Some of the things that Edison filmed with his early motion picture camera included a man doing tricks on his single gear bike and two cats boxing with each other. One of the lesser-known ideas of Edison was concrete furniture. It came from a failed attempt at making concrete houses. Edison used what was supposedly a lightweight tub of concrete to manufacture various home furnishings. Edison shipped out some of his furnishings to put them on display, but they arrived broken up. This caused Edison to close down his line of concrete creations for good. Many today consider Edison to have been an atheist, but this is not true. Edison had spiritual and religious beliefs that were a mix between pantheism and deism. Thomas Edison never really invented major breakthroughs. He took credit for the inventions of others, and most of his patents were modifications on already existing ideas. Edison was, however, a very good businessman, and used his business skills to improve on current ideas instead of inventing new ones. Edison died of complications of diabetes on October 18, 1931.
While there are lesser known inventors who have done greater things than Edison and are more deserving of the praises and rewards given to him, there is no doubt that he certainly had an impact on the world. So ends the history of Thomas Edison.
After watching the video, we know Thomas Edison was not the first guy who invented the light bulb. So that's my question. Why do we think that Edison was the first person who invented light bulb? Does anyone know? Okay, that's my job. Because Thomas Edison was very rich, he held 1,039 patents, so he made lots of money. And he asked the people to publish books to say he was a great inventor. And like a genius is 1%, 1% inspiration and 99% perspiration. And that's why he was significant, because he has lots of money and he know how to ask people. He asked people to publish book for him. He know how to control the truth, to tell everyone the lie, not the lie to maybe to beautiful the truth. And who is good at patent? Who is good at patent? What is 1039 divided by 84? Yeah, it's about 12, right? What does it mean? It means Thomas Edison should invent one new inventor. Invent one new thing per month.
That's
impossible, right?
Yeah.
That's
how
impossible.
You invent things when you're 1 year old.
And I said, Thomas Edison spent 2 years to invent the light bulb. And how he held lots of patents. Because he was good at getting patents. The most famous case is he had a patent about alternate current generator. Do you know DC and AC? You should know. Okay. Because at that time, Thomas Edison has paid lots of money for direct current, DC. But DC is limited. DC is not good as... it was worse than AC. And nowadays we use AC. Everyone know? Nowadays we use AC. And Tesla was Thomas Edison's partner. Tesla told Thomas Edison, this is really bad. AC is good. AC is great. But because Thomas Edison has paid lots of money, so Thomas Edison defend Tesla. And he used DC. Thomas Edison used the DC to heal people and tell everyone it's AC. You know? Thomas Edison used direct current to kill people, and tell everyone it's alternate current. Alternate current is dangerous, so people don't use it. Yeah. But it's a lie. He just want to make money because he had. After a few years, people know it's Thomas Edison's lie. So At that time, Tesla has passed away. So Thomas Edison stole the patents of DC, of AC from Tesla's daughter. So maybe at last we say, why is Thomas Edison significant? Maybe I would say because he was good at to tell everyone he wanted to tell, and he know, and he was rich, and he know how to get the patent. That's all. Thank you.
So who invented the light, or is it Tesla?
No, not Tesla. Tesla invents an alternate current generator.
Okay,
Shakespeare Company.
we have...
William Shakespeare, one of the greatest authors of all time, was born in Stratford-upon-Avon, England. His actual birth date is uncertain, but most scholars believe he was born on or near April 23rd, 1564.
We think he may have been educated in the King's School at Stratford because that would have been typical for a child with a father who was an alderman. What we do know is that he didn't go to university.
We have a marriage record for Shakespeare to Anne Hathaway in 1585. We also have baptism records for a daughter and a set of twins. And we also know that his son, Hamnet, one of the twins, died.
Shakespeare moved to London in the late 1580s. By the early 1590s, we know he's writing, and we know that he's acting.
By 1597, Shakespeare had authored 15 of the 37 plays attributed to him, including Romeo and Juliet, Comedy of Errors, and The Merry Wives of Windsor.
People think of William Shakespeare as an artist, a playwright. He was a pretty good businessman.
In 1599, he built the largest open-air amphitheater in London, the Globe Theatre.
He was an entrepreneur. He knew his market. He knew how to cater to that market. He made shrewd real estate investments.
Shakespeare's company, the Lord Chamberlain's Men, changed its name to the King's Men when King James became its patron in 1603. This was a mark of exceptional prestige.
The different types of Shakespeare plays are separated into histories, comedies, tragedies, and then later on tragicomedies.
Shakespeare's phrases, the ways he used words, are so common that people often get mixed up and can't remember if they came from the Bible or from Shakespeare. My grandmother used to say, when something bad happened, these were the slings and arrows of everyday life. She was not an educated woman, and she didn't go to Shakespeare plays. She didn't get that one from the Bible.
What scholars call Shakespeare's middle period from 1595 to 1605 included such classic comedies as Midsummer Night's Dream, As You Like It, Twelfth Night, and Much Ado About Nothing. He also produced Hamlet, Othello, and Macbeth during this period.
Right at the cusp where Shakespeare begins to write Lear, it tips into what we could call the later Shakespeare. And this period produces Lear, Anthony and Cleopatra, Tempest, Winter's Tale, Pericles, Cymbeline.
Shakespeare wrote great stories. For example, one of the stories starts with a king who is tired, he doesn't want to govern anymore, so he says to his three daughters, I'm going to separate the kingdom between the three of you, but it's going to be based on who tells me how much they love me. However much you love me, that's how much of the kingdom you're going to get. Now that's going to make me sit up. I mean, what a way to start a story. And that's King Lear.
Shakespeare was not only a playwright, he also was a poet, partly because of economic necessity. During the early 1590s, plague closed the theaters in London, and there was quite a vogue for producing sonnets.
Shakespeare wrote 154 sonnets, in addition to several narrative poems.
Shakespeare worked the English language, milked it for all it was worth, made up words if it didn't give him the right words. He is one of the first professional writers.
The details of William Shakespeare's death remain a mystery, but scholars believe he died on his birthday, April 23rd, 1616. In the 400 years since, Shakespeare's influence has only grown. His writing is the second most quoted after the Bible. He has been credited with introducing almost 3,000 words to the English language, and a Google search on Shakespeare returns more than 140 million results.
Shakespeare talked about the human condition. He explains to us how we think, how we feel, the human psyche. He eloquently explains it.
In the 18th century, questions arose about the authorship of Shakespeare's work. Given the vague details we know of his life, his lack of higher education, and the similarity of his plays to others of the day. Today, most scholars believe Shakespeare wrote all of his plays and sonnets.
I would argue that Shakespeare's legacy is the most influential figure in human civilization.
president in the world. And he do a lot of things. And does a lot of things. And he born to be a pope.
It's okay.
He born in 1809 and died in 1865. Why is he significant? And the first one reason is he is USA president and he is the 60th American president. He did a lot of things and he not only overcome many crises but also promote America economic development. So Lincoln is known as one of the greatest American
citizens. Do you want to use the microphone? Yeah, that's also you can see. Maybe you should use the microphone. Well, it's so loud. We can turn it down a little bit. Pick one to say again. Turn it down a little bit. Maybe you should use the microphone. Come and see
the second reason is
your microphone. Yes, please.
And the second reason is America's Civil War, and Lincoln released the North to win the war, and solve many problems why South would start a war. And finally, he makes the North and South perfect originally.
The Emancipation Proclamation was released by the President of the United States, Abraham Lincoln, and was talking about all slaves in Confederate States of America should enjoy their freedom. And this declaration didn't actually release all slaves, but intensified the authority of slaves and paved the way about abolishing the slavery system. And Gettysburg Address. This is the most famous speech about Lincoln and was published at Gettysburg National Cemetery. This speech was supporting all men are created equal. The President of the United States, Abraham Lincoln, only used less than 300 words to define the Civil War and was talking about not only fight for the survival of the Federation, but also fight for freedom and equal. Influence. Slavery system. Slaves was a serious problem when the President Abraham Lincoln was in office. As you can see, many slaves were being sold and misused. In the Civil War, many slaves fought for themselves and for the North side. In the end of the Civil War, Lincoln used abolishing the slavery system as bad and won the presidential election. And this is a short video.
Liked and respected, and that was the quality of being a wise old man. That's one of the things that made him a successful president.
Abraham Lincoln was born on February 12, 1809. He spent his first years in a log cabin in rural Kentucky. His mother's death when he was 9 years old deeply affected him and put more tension on his already strained relationship with his father.
He regarded his father as lacking ambition, as lazy, as anti-intellectual. All the things that Lincoln wanted to escape from, he saw in his father.
A love of knowledge made Lincoln into an intelligent, well-spoken, and popular young man, as he worked a series of odd jobs in New Salem, Illinois.
When Lincoln talked, people listened. Whether that was around the around pot-bellied stoves, at storefronts, at courthouses.
After a term in the Illinois State Legislature, Lincoln decided to teach himself law. He passed the bar in 1837 and moved to Springfield, where he met Mary Todd.
Anybody who was watching what was going on in Springfield in those years knew that this was a fellow who was going to make a name for himself in some way, and Mary was attracted to that.
Abraham Lincoln and Mary Todd were married on November 4, 1842. Lincoln spent his next years practicing law. But in 1858, he decided to challenge Stephen Douglas for his seat in the U.S. Senate. Though Lincoln lost the election, he got the attention of National Republican Party leaders and won the party's nomination for president in 1860. In the national race, he would again face Stephen Douglas.
Stephen Douglas is saying that democracy is compatible with slavery. Lincoln has to undo that idea, or he won't be able successfully to challenge slavery.
Lincoln won the election, but his views on slavery did not make him a welcome leader in the South. By his inauguration in March 1861, 7 Southern states had seceded from the Union. On April 12, 1861, the Confederacy fired on Fort Sumter and began America's most deadly war. At first, Lincoln made the war about maintaining the Union so as not to offend the loyal slave states. But eventually, he shifted the cause to abolishing slavery. And on January 1st, 1863, Abraham Lincoln issued the Emancipation Proclamation. Slavery was over. Lincoln easily won the election in 1864, and it would only be a few more months before Confederate General Robert E. Lee would surrender. With the war over, Lincoln could look forward to better times. Reconstruction had already begun, but there were those that didn't readily accept the outcome of the war.
John Wilkes Booth believed that Abraham Lincoln was truly an evil man, and Booth believed that by killing him, he would be doing a service to both his nation and to his race.
On April 14, 1865, John Wilkes Booth shot the president at Ford's Theater in Washington, D.C. Lincoln was taken across the street to a boarding house, where he died 9 hours later. The nation had lost a great leader at a time they needed him most.
Reconstruction was in a totally different picture. It might not have been a need for a civil rights movement. It might not have been a need for Martin Luther King Jr. and Lincoln for not being a citizen.
Now I'm introduce a movie about Abraham Lincoln.
Another short video.
Thank you.
This movie including the Civil War and slavery system.
About
killing vampires.
So he's a vampire. After he died, or when he's still alive?
Yeah, before he alive.
Before he alive.
Huh? Before he died.
Before he died. Okay.
References.
Just Wikipedia. Alright, that's easy. Alright, is anything else? Do you have any conclusion of this guy?
Do you have any questions?
Okay.
Thanks for your listening.
Alright, very good.
我有done，很简单吗？包括很简单吗？没有想象中恐怖吧？其实你们都大概只有讲10分钟不到，放大概5分钟一片，对不对？而且你们想很多。Well, I think the process is important. 那你们去找啊，去认识他，因为这些人都是我不是随便挑的人的，我也是 Google 的，就是 the most influential people in the U.S. and in the U.K. Okay, 这位是 Google 来的，alright. 今天介绍的只有 one Englishman 是 Shakespeare，
对，其他都是美国人，对哈，OK。搞了半天，不知道他是英国人。英国美国，还是比较文艺青年的那种都是英国的。文艺青年，你说比较文艺出身的那种。对啊。这比较书生的，因为都是美国人就比较没有。他比较书生的那种。
美国人也有good writer， 但是 Shakespeare is one of the most writer in overall。 OK， 他真的是，就那个年代他可以做到这样，真的很厉害。 Shakespeare 也是真的人啊，虽然他写的故事很多都假的嘛，罗密欧与朱丽叶是假的啊，可是如果你去意大里，他会跟你说这是罗密欧与朱丽叶的故乡，就这样，好可怕哦。对啊，很可怕。他说这些都是杜撰的吗？Alright，好，可以吗？签好了没有？ Alright, 好 ，This is my problem， 就一些事情要说。好，来，presentation， 我们12周就会结束了，因为13周那个原本就一，他们两个都退课了。好 ，PPT required， 我觉得 I think you did a good job. Okay, a short video, significant one has been done. 其实 video 里面有些都会说，但是你们就是用自己的话说。我知道有些人是念稿子的，拜托就是你知道，顺一下好不好？不要听起来就是念的，OK。 So do some preparation, okay? 自己做一些努力。所以11、12周我们会 over presentation。下个礼拜要 present 的是心仪跟湘琳有来吗？怎么样？是 Walt Disney。等一下 ，wait。然后玉凯跟雅文，玉凯有来，雅文没有来哈。好，你们是 Michael Jackson。尤兰，you will be David Beckham。湘琳跟丽仪，你们是 Beatles。好，那我们刚刚。 只有一部分人投跑了，反正因为我们13周本来要报告，但是因为那个又没有了，对不对？所以13周我们就提早看影集，所以13、14、15、16我们就会看两个影集。第一个看我们要看 Downton Abbey， 是什么唐顿庄园？你没有看过吗？没有。有听过吗？其实平常除了滑手机外，还会做什么休闲娱乐吗？我有看过什么恶魔蛙人啊，死亡笔记本啊。那个刚刚讲的都不是英文版的。你先追我看，《Bed in the Dark Knight》我有看，好不好 ？Thank you。好 ，So Downton Abbey 它就是讲了一个lord，一个爵位的人他的故事。OK，我先强调一下，他有三个女儿，可是当时呢，应该怎么讲？ 就是一直以来都是传子不传女，OK， 然后女生的顺序会影响你接，对于皇室而言，女生生下来女生的顺序会影响。假如说你是长女，可是你下面有个弟弟，那他的继承权会在你前面。这个规矩在皇室大概2、3年前就已经被 abolish 被废除了 ，OK， 那在这个之前都是传子。 讲过嘛，就是女传子不传女的 ，OK？ 所以这个故事里面呢，这个 Lord Grantham 他就遇到一个困难，就是他有三个女生，那他就要想办法把他女生，就是把他的长女找一个人嫁，然后这个人是跟他门当户对的，然后你知道，就是他的 estate， 他 real estate， 他的财产，他的 property 跟地产可以保存下来。Okay, 所以在讲这个故事，那这故事里面也有一点点阶级的那个在，因为他们都是大小姐、跟老爷还有夫人，所以他们就会有很多仆人啊这样子。OK， 所以我觉得蛮有趣的。我应该给你看一集啦，剩下你可以自己追。它有六季，
六季、
五季还六季，我忘了。
追到民国几百年啊？
你们就不用啊，你们追一季就可以，或追几集就可以，大概有个那个，你们自己可以回家追。OK。好，第二个呢，要给你看这个 Crown， 它是去年新的影集，才出一季而已。它在讲现代伊丽莎白女王的故事。那第一季是在讲她刚登基的那十年的故事，就是伦敦遇到埋害啊，还有丘吉尔那个时候的掌权，她跟丘吉尔之间的关系，还有一点点她跟她先生之间的关系。那第二季就会再演别的，但她还没有出来。OK， 那我会给你看第一季，这两个都是看第一季的第一集。OK。The Help 这两个呢是讲那个黑人帮佣的。刚刚介绍总介绍 Oprah 的时候就有讲说，他奶奶对他的期望。Oprah 自己在那个影片里面说，奶奶对我的期望就是我成为一个housemaid， 然后 people can treat me with some dignity and respect。Okay， 所以当时他奶奶就是那个时候的人呐、啊，黑人其实就是只能去帮佣。所以这个故事里面也有说。那这是电影，我把它分上下两集看 ，OK？ 好，所以十七周是 discussion on selected films， 因为我想帮助你写这个 term paper 啦，我怕你写不出来，我怕你去 Google、Wikipedia， 然后随便给我动 ，OK？ Plagiarism 这叫做剽窃，我会看的，你小心一点 ，OK？ 因为这很简单，反正呢，你们的程度到哪里，我也不是不知道啦。你写出来那个句子呢，看起来不像你写的，我就会去 Google 你是从哪里抄来的。现在 Google 很厉害 ，OK？ 所以 use your own words。这很重要 ，OK。好，那我会帮你们，我们就做一点 short discussion。那我刚刚说十七周，本来要带你们去云南吃饭，可是他只能吃午餐，他没有吃早点的。早点要自己付钱啊，我不好意思把你们带去。所以呢，所以我刚刚做的决定是，十七周我们还是来，然后我请你们喝咖啡，好不好？就喝饮料。好啊，像那个 TA 不去买啊，你们就带早餐啊 ，whatever。你不带东西来，至少也有咖啡啦。好，可以吗？啊，不喝咖啡就再去点说你要什么。
好。
好，可以吗？因为像我可能就会喝抹茶牛奶，
好
抹茶拿铁之类的，好吗？那第十八周我们要交 term paper 在 iPhone 上，就是电子档就好。那你的 term paper 要怎么写啊？是reflection on the selected movie and dramas， OK？ Compare and contrast these three films， What have you learned from these films？ 然后记得是十二号的自私页哦。Deadline 是十八周。Okay. 你交电子档，可是十八周那天我会在教室里面，就是 I have to be there， I have to be there， 但是我就会等你交。那一样是，反正十八周那天是十三号吧，我记得还是十一号，我忘了，十一号吗？一月十一号吧？
没有吧，十三号吧？
还是十七号？
十七号吧？
啊，十七号。那天的中午十二点十分 ，Island 那个资料夹就会关起来。It's the same thing. I don't take late work.
Okay.
好，这 reflection 好像三十趴吧。OK， 刚刚的 presentation 三十趴，可是 I feel like they all did a wonderful job。我觉得你们做的比我想象中的好很多，所以，所以同那个 presentation 的分数应该是蛮高的，我目前都打蛮高分的，所以 don't worry about it。OK， 我是希望如果你是读 Wikipedia， 你不要照念 ，use your own words， 可以吗？像文文跟那个龙龙，他们就做的不错啊，我觉得 it's quite your word， 就是你用你自己的话说出来，可以吗？消化一下它的内容，然后自己用自己的话说出来。I don't really care， 我没有很在意 fluency and accuracy。I think it's a good practice， being able to do a PowerPoint presentation is a practice， 是需要练习的，所以我就觉得文字的部分还好，可以吗？有没有问题？
没有。
今天报告完之后要来哦，
好，
这两周而已，就下一周了哈，就这样了哈。好，就这样啦 ，I'll see you next week。下次会回去语言就要上课了。今天是因为电脑坏掉了，它完全没有办法投影，它可以有声音。那我想说搞屁啊，今天没有报告，赶快教室。 Alright, so 下礼拜应该是原定教室，对吗？